Hey, Bag Family, what's happening? Back with another video. In case this is your first video, my name is Rick, and this is...
Cynthia.
That's right. Back at it again. In today's video, we've been wanting to make this video for the longest, and somehow, when you get sidetracked from doing so many different things, you just forget about it. But today's video is for military service members in the illusion or America. All right, stay tuned. Today's video is about a message to our military service members in the U.S. military and stuff. Okay, how that sound?
Sounds
pretty good?
Good.
All right. Well, briefly, you know, I played football in high school, yada, yada. I was good, not so good, whatever. You know, supposed to go pro, go to college, all that good stuff. Bottom line, in 1983, I had a choice to make in life. Mm-hmm. Head down the wrong path or do something that'll tie you over until you figure it out. So I decided in 1983, I didn't want to go down the wrong path of drugs and blase, blase. So I said, let's try the U.S. Army military stuff. So I had just dropped out of college 2 years prior to that and stuff, and so like again, it was like a downward spiral. So I said, hey, let's try the Army and stuff, you know what I'm saying? So anyway, I went and signed up for the Army and stuff like that, you know, and spent the next 15 years in the U.S. Army. And I would like to share some strategies that I found to be successful in the military as well as unsuccessful and stuff, right? And Sweet Juicy Mama is going to share some perspective as being how do they call it?
Military wife,
or the
soldier's
wife, or whatever the case may be, and stuff, okay? But anyway, yeah, I was in 1983 and I got out in 98. And a career of ups and downs, and ups and downs, and ups and downs. Now, let me go ahead and say this before we get into depth. Now, I'm not sure about the other branches of service, but in the Army, there's this unwritten rule that if you're sick or you're ailing, don't go to sick call. A sick call is basically the hospital or the clinic or the pharmacy or whatever. You go there for treatment. Uh-huh. So the unwritten rule is if you're in the military, don't go to sick call because that's a sign of weakness, or you're riding sick call because you don't want to do work and things of that sort.
That's a lie.
That is the wrong excuse, guys. Reason being, if you're in the military, let's just say, hypothetically speaking, you suffer from a rash that you break out all over your body, and that happens throughout your military career. When it comes time for you to separate from service, whether you just say, hey, enough of this shit and I'm out, or if you say, hey, I'm about to retire, or they just put your ass out because you keep breaking out in rashes. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That needs to be documented in your record. So if you break out, or if you feel sick,
that's your proof,
or if you feel dizzy or anything, take your ass to sick call,
yeah.
Have it documented in your records. Because when I got out in 98, this guy said, you know me, I wanted out when it came time to get out. Now, I was so eager to get in 1983 because I didn't want to continue the downward spiral. And so, but when it came 15 years later, 1998, when it came time to get out, man, I was ready to get out with a passion. You understand what I'm saying? So I didn't want to have anything else to do with the U.S. military. I was like fed up. If you can get like fed up to here, I was fed up to here. And so anyway, this guy said at the briefing, the outbriefing, he said, hey, listen, if there's anything wrong with you, if there's anything wrong with you,
document it
on this piece of paper right here, because if it develops and becomes problematic later on in life, you need this proof here as far as claim. Now, I don't know if I had said this earlier, but the reason why you go to the doctor while you're in the military is to document illnesses, injuries, so on and so forth, okay? So when it comes time to get out, you have a financial claim that you can make against the U.S. Government. You understand what I'm saying? And so the guy said, write down everything that's wrong with you right now, because later on, if it becomes a problem in life, you know, you need to have some proof that you're saying, hey, this is a problem. So I wrote down as many things as I could, and today we received compensation for that. And I'm telling military service members that are in the military, whether you're in the field, which means the jungle or training exercise where you go out there and act like you're at war, you know what I'm saying? Makeshift. Yeah, playing, you know what I'm saying? The field environment, that's what they call it. Or if you go to NTC, California, where you're in a desert environment where you're acting like you're fighting.
And your wife called.
There you go. Get you out of some field training exercises. Or if you actually go to war like I did in Desert Shield, Desert Storm, if you have some illnesses coming from that or anything wrong with you, have that documented so you have a claim against the military when you get out. Like, for example, right now, they've come out with something that says, not like, it's similar to Agent Orange, but they said, if you have respiratory conditions,
yes,
you can put in a claim against the military because of burning open pit stuff in Desert Shield, Desert Storm. And so a tremendous amount of veterans are putting in claims to say, hey, look, I do have asthma. Mm-hmm. I do have sinusitis. I do have respiratory conditions. So if you're in the military, please heed my word. If anything goes wrong with you, and I mean, you ain't got to milk it. You know, I broke a fingernail, you run there. No, I'm not talking about something like that.
Just every time you go to the doctor and they does, you know, something, give you some kind of medication for it, mm-hmm. write it down.
Right. Yeah, like the fingernail scenario. If you break a fingernail, there's no need to go there. But if you smash a finger or break a finger doing something or some fuel splashes into your eyes, yes, go to the doctor and get that documented, because you never know how that'll develop into the future.
And not only that, if you're constantly having migraines.
Migraines,
stuff
exactly
like
right.
that, yes. Pain in your hip or your toes keep breaking out, right. You know, stuff like that. Put it down, document it.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And also too, now, guys, if you are married in the military, mm-hmm. and you're experiencing some things where you might not necessarily want to go to the doctor or can go to the doctor, share that information with your spouse so she's a witness to say,
to
yes,
know about it, yeah.
I did see him break out, using the hive scenario. I did see him break out like this. Or if he has sleep apnea, mm-hmm. the wife could say, yes,
I hear this at night.
I'm looking at him at night, yes. and he stopped breathing and such and such. That is a witness to help you with your claim against the government. And we all could use some extra money from time to time. So either you put that money in your pocket, which is rightfully deserved because mm-hmm. you're in the military, or you let some fat ass politician enjoy it on a golf course, or, you know, whatever the case may be. It's either them or us, and I say us. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
So that's what we wanted to share with you about being in the military. Now, when I was in the military,
and guys, if you, you know, some things like they don't like, you know, they say men don't like going to the doctor and everything.
Even, macho.
And if you have certain problems that you want to, you don't want to share with the doctor or nurse, and you can't share it with your wife, mm-hmm. please let her know so you guys can get, you know, have it documented.
for your compensation.
Even if you don't want to go. Mm-hmm. But ladies, force them to go.
That's right.
I suggest, you never know. It could be somewhere you have bowel, IBS,
mm-hmm, yep.
And you can't use it the way you're supposed to.
Right.
You never know, it could turn into something big.
Major, exactly right.
It could be
right.
Colon cancer, mm-hmm, or something. Mm-hmm. But get to the doctor, guys.
Exactly right.
It doesn't help, mm-hmm, especially if you get sick and she's there with the children and he's gone or she's
no
gone.
No compensation, exactly right.
It doesn't help.
Harder.
It's best to stay and stick together with this.
Exactly right.
You know, sickness or whatever.
Right. Now, my story again now is, I got out of the, I dropped out of college where I was playing football. I was on the scholarship, track and football. And so anyway, never had an injury. High school football career, no injuries. 2 years of college football career, no injuries. Joined the military, get a football injury, guys. So I got an AC separation in the left shoulder. And so they started documenting, this guy, has an AC separation where the bone is protruding up. Not out of, it didn't break the skin. It just, you could see the indent in the skin.
Yeah, it used to be bad. Because
right here.
It used to be poking up at times.
Yeah, up a little
just
bit.
Like that.
So right there. And so eventually I had surgery for it, mm-hmm, and received compensation for it. And because of the inability to use this left hand, like knock a motherfucker out when you want to, you got to overcompensate with hitting with the right. You see what I'm saying? So as a result of knocking so many people out using the right and not using the left, I was able to put a claim in to say, hey, listen, because of in the military.
Happened on their grounds.
I broke this AC. And now it's limited operation where I got to knock everybody out with the right hand. It's overuse on this one as a result of this one. So I was able to have disability compensation for this one as well as this one. And it goes on and on and on, if you understand what I'm saying.
I hope they're getting it.
Uh-huh. And so anyway, that is only talking about one aspect of surviving in the military. Okay. You want to be covered. Because they in the military in America, there's a slogan that says it's a great place to start. It never says anything about finishing. So if you read between the lines, you make sure you get to the finish line before they do.
Exactly.
And so anyway, that's just one of the things. And while I was in the military, you have access to educational benefits. Mm-hmm. Now, you can either go out and chase the women, you know what I'm saying, or get your new car. Well, you shine it every weekend, or you get your butt into the school on those weekends for seminars, Saturday, mm-hmm, Sunday class, or class during lunch break, or
take advantage.
Now, I had dropped out of college, if you know my story, but when I went back into the military, they froze some of the student loan debt that I had. I think they forgive it now, but anyway.
Let's just make this clear. You didn't go back into the military. You had just went into the military.
Say it again, sweet mama.
You said when I went back into the military. Went once.
Yeah, only one time. I'm sorry. Thank you for that, sweet, mm-hmm, mama. So once I got out of the civilian environment and went into the college, went into the military, mm-hmm, I found out that they had froze the student loan, which means you don't have to pay interest on that. And always being a business major, even when I didn't go to class, I always loved the subject of business because, bottom line, business people run the world. As simple as that. And so anyway, they had froze the interest on the loan as a result of being in the military. So I was like, shit, if they're gonna freeze this with no interest, I'm gonna save some money. So I paid the loan off in like 6 months. Loan was finished and stuff, you know what I'm saying? Then I said, hey, I'm going to finish up these college degrees. So I was able to get associates, a bachelor's and a master's and a certification and blah, blah, blah. In the military, because they were paying for it. I was taking, like, if you guys are familiar with this, when you're a full-time student in college, you're classified as having 15 semester hours per term.
He was doing it because I was there.
Yeah, I was taking 15 semester hours or per term or per semester in college, and the white establishment was opposed to that. Like, hey, can you handle this? And I said, just give me the opportunity. You don't understand where I'm coming from. Inner city, single mom household, you know, blase, blase, blase. So give me the opportunity. And so they was giving me the opportunity. Guys, I was knocking out those classes left and right. Next term, another 15 semester hours. Next term, I mean, it got to the point where they stopped questioning, could I
do it
successfully? I was able to do it. I do the research. Sweet Juicy Mama would help me with typing and stuff like that. I would come in and finalize the project.
I stayed in Kinko's.
See what I'm saying? And so that's another opportunity for you if you're in the military. Take advantage of those college courses, correspondent courses, workshops, seminars, and they always want people for training. You know what I'm saying? And I always had my hand up. I had my hand up for volunteering for so much training. They said, man, just put your hand down. I wanted to be a sniper. I wanted to be special forces. I wanted to be a ranger. I wanted to
be. We can give it to them.
Yeah, I wanted to jump out of airplanes and stuff. There always was a reason why they said, you don't qualify. You know what I'm saying?
They saw something in you.
Something in me. So anyway, I just went ahead and just sat tight until my time came up. But again, take advantage of those educational opportunities while you're in the military, because you never know when you can use those skills later on. Fast forward now, we're in
Africa.
West Africa, the
Gambia. I was about to say, ladies, stay with them, work with them.
Right.
It does pays off.
Yes.
It do.
Yeah, and look, now we're utilizing those skills.
Yeah.
We're utilizing those skills that we learned in the military and stuff like that. So anyway, that is the second benefit. And the next benefit is, you know, that as long as you're in the military, you're going to get paid. You can either get the two payments, one in the middle month and one at the end of the month.
It's so it run out before the middle.
Right. No, that's true. But it teaches you how to budget.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
It did.
So the way we would handle it is, Sweet Juicy Mama would look at the money, just like we do now. Fast forward again. She would look at the money and figure out, hey, we're going to pay this bill, pay that bill, and things of that sort, right? And so, again, you're going to get paid. And there are so many benefits in the military.
Yeah, it is.
They are going to go by the wayside unless you use them. You understand what I'm
so
saying?
So many and a lot don't know.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, if you're in the military, you qualify for them to give you a loan if you want to buy a house. We use that benefit. When we bought our house in, what was it, 2006? Or 1996?
96.
We used the Veteran Home Loans Program, you know what I'm saying?
Actually, we used that plus another program that we were in, some business thing we were in.
Exactly right. Yeah. And so, you know, we use that benefit and stuff, you know, because again, there are a lot of benefits that are available to you. You have to use them. If you don't use them, then, you know, you pretty much just giving away free stuff. And so
and about that credit, don't worry about that.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, we had good credit. I mean, our credit was very high.
Very high back
but
in the
that,
day.
But that, we don't, credit don't mean anything to me.
Yeah. Nowadays, once you learn the real deal.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, once you learn the real deal. And so anyway.
It's a trap.
Yeah, it is a trap. It is a trap. But you also got, you know, different places where you can go, like commissary. Mm-hmm. That's sort of like basically a military Walmart. Mm-hmm. And you got like a classic store where you can basically go and, you know, get a discounted liquor and stuff like
also,
that.
Also, you can go, like, I don't know if they still have it. Like, we used to go to the, not the commissary. What's the other one? The PX.
That's.
They have something
like
where you,
too,
they give you some kind of like a credit card or something. You can go and use that. And so much amount on it. Right. They will let you use something. I remember going to use that. I don't know what they call it.
But. Yeah, and exactly right. And now, guys, one more thing, too. Now, getting back to the medical stuff. As it processes through my Kevlar helmet here, you know what I'm saying? A friend gave this to me over here. He didn't like the Gambia, was trying another place on the African continent, so he gave me this Kevlar helmet. So thank you, buddy, and hope you're enjoying where you are now. But anyway, once you get out the military, make sure you get a copy of something that's called your 201 file. It documents everything that happened to you while you was in the military, as far as medical. So when you put in and you say, hey, going back to the hive scenario, you know what I'm saying? I have hives, and they say, well, we don't see in your military records. You can say, that's a damn lie. Here's my proof. You print out the copy from your 201 file or disk or whatever, a packet of papers saying each time you went to the doctor, you can say, here's my proof. I went on this date, this date, this date, this date. Mm-hmm. You're a damn lie. Give me my compensation. So that is pretty important.
They will lose it.
They will lose it, guys. For those of y'all that are in the military, you understand what I'm saying? So did I leave out anything, sweet mama?
Medical, well, I think when you use medical.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the medical. Once you're in the military, guys, all medical is free. That's how it should really be, outside the military, too. But that's a whole nother video. You're fully eligible for medical services and dental also. And your spouse and your dependents, your immediate family, you know, a son and daughter, they're available for it, too.
I think if you, I guess it's... college too for the children.
Some of them. Yeah. And I want to conclude the video, guys, with this. When I got out the military in 1998, I wanted to be completely finished with the military. I did not file a claim for compensation until about 2012, 2014. Mm-hmm. During that time frame, a lot of things happened to me, guys. A lot of things happened to me. Yes. And people that I would come in contact with, because we stayed in this military town. So I'm gonna take this off.
It's heavy.
Let's see if you could tell what military town it was. Okay. We stayed in a military town called Fort Campbell, Kentucky. You know, but we stayed on the Clarksville side, even though we was a hop, skip, and a jump from Kentucky.
Tennessee.
So, yeah, Tennessee. And so anyway, guys, what was I talking about?
I don't know. You made me forget. Somebody told you something about...
Okay, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes. See, you put a claim in for that, too. So anyway...
If the wife can put it in, too, because I'm starting to not got to remember, too.
So. Yeah. So anyway, one more time. Yeah. Okay, but anyway,
told
the guys kept saying, hey, man, you should put in... you know, a claim for disability compensation. I was like, man, I don't want to have anything to do with that. I don't been out this long, and I'm feeling all these illnesses and all this stuff.
He brushed me off.
Yeah, she kept saying.
I said it before those guys.
Yeah, she did.
Because I'm like, you know, you never know what's going to happen.
Right.
Let's do it just for the hell of it. Just we don't know if we're going to need it. Right. At that time, we didn't need it, you know.
Exactly right.
But let's do it. I don't want that stuff.
Yeah, that was me. That was my response.
Shut up,
because they put, it's not easy now. Because again, not. Those politicians want the money to go surfing and fishing and all that. If you don't want it, they will take it. Mm-hmm. So if you've earned it, like I say, you earned it, put in for it so you can get it. It's better to have money in your pocket than them have money in their pocket because they're not earning it.
Exactly.
They're just jabber jawing. They're not putting their lives out there on the line. You know what I'm saying? For some fraudulent reason, you know what I'm saying? So anyway, people just kept saying, hey man, you know, just one after another, hey man, go ahead and put in for, hey, I don't wanna have anything to do with that. And so finally, I mean, I got broke down to the point where, no, this one white guy walked up to me, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And he was adamant.
He was.
He said, you're gonna put in for a military compensation. I was like, no.
And I brought two days, a
whole year.
Was it a whole year?
I skipped the guy a whole year, and then all of a sudden
we saw him in Depot.
Popped up again.
We saw him in the store.
That's fate. And he said, hey man, what
no,
happened?
No, this is not what it is. Okay. He was like, there you go, let's go this way.
Yeah, I was trying to avoid him.
He tried to avoid the guy. And I'm like, Rick, maybe he has something good to tell you.
Right.
Or I don't even want to hear it. I don't want to hear it.
Yeah.
Let's go this way. And then the next time, you saw him by yourself.
Yeah, no, we both ran into him at Rural King.
Okay, yeah, Rural King.
And so
we kept seeing him.
Yeah, I skipped the guy for a whole year. So and it just shows you how faith is. The guy bumps into us again and says, hey.
Come to his house.
You're not getting away this time. Be at my house at such and such a time. Blase, blase. So I was like, hey. Maybe this is a sign of faith.
Mm-hmm.
I don't diss all these people over the years. I think it was once I had got out, I think it was like maybe 16, 18 years that had went past where I'm suffering from stuff that I had got in the military as well as going to Desert Shield, Desert Storm. And she kept saying, Rick, and I was like, no. And so this guy, we went to his house and this
You're
is what
in
got
a small trailer.
Yeah,
it was like in the South.
Yep. He had a house, but a little small trailer on the side.
It was small, guys.
Yep.
And it was like, we're being way out in the country, but it wasn't. We was just, it was weird. But.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so we talked to the guy. He said, hey, listen. And I like when people shoot it to me straight from the hip.
He did.
He said, stop being so selfish.
He did.
It's not just about you. Mm-hmm. If something happens to you, you're going to leave your wife and your seven children without a source of income.
He did say that.
Nobody had explained it to me like that before. Mm-hmm. And so I finally listened to the guy. So he pulled out some examples of paperwork and it guided me through the process. I mean, he got me to the extent where I learned the process better than he did. Uh-huh. You understand what I'm saying? And so anyway, to make a long story short, we put in for compensation. We received the compensation and
preparation wasn't good, though.
Yeah, so anyway, so if something happens, Sweet Juicy Mama's taken care of because of the benefits that are offered when you join the U.S. military, but you got to claim it. You can't rely on them to give it to you because ain't nobody going to give you nothing. You know what I'm saying? You got to put out, you got to claim it as yours and stuff. And so anyway,
much out there too.
If there's some other veteran members that are watching this video, because I know there are a lot of veterans that are coming to the Gambia, as well as that are watching us in the diaspora. So if you're watching this, please heed our words about taking advantage of the benefits that are in the military.
That is yours.
And the rank structure is a whole nother thing. Mm-hmm. Now, to me, the military is no different than the racist society that it comes from. Mm-hmm. Those racist Ku Klux Klan members that are out there, you know what I'm saying? They come into the military as officers and as NCOs or sergeants or non-commissioned officers, as it may be. And you're going to have problems and difficulties with them just like you were in the civilian sector. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? And even though they got these rules and regulations and all that, just like the civilian part where they got laws and stuff like that, statutes, you know, somebody has to enforce that. And more times than not, they don't enforce it. So you're at the mercy of fending for yourself. You understand what I'm saying? So the only thing I can tell you is suck it up.
Stay strong.
Stay strong. And when you get a chance to get the hell out of there, get the hell out of there. Mm-hmm. Because when I found myself in problematic units where there was racist KKK type leadership, first opportunity I got to transfer out of there, I transferred the hell out of there. You understand?
Many times.
And so that will help you if you're in a place where you hate it. You see what I'm saying? You can go into another battalion, another brigade, another division, but get away from those people. You understand what I'm saying? Because there's nothing good going to come out of that. It's going to get to the point where the bubble will bust. You understand what I'm saying? And so...
almost was there.
Yeah, almost was there. You know what I'm saying? So anyway, hopefully you found something enjoyable and that you can use pertaining to this. If you're in the military, it might apply if you're in the fire department or the police department. You know, it's all paramilitary, you know what I'm saying? National Guard, all that stuff. It all intertwines and stuff, so.
And the ladies, the husband will need that support.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, I understand it's gonna probably be rough on you too, but he would definitely need that support.
That's right.
So you gotta stay strong too, ladies.
Right.
I mean, do whatever you can to just keep going. I mean, it's hard sometimes when he went away.
Overseas.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Even when he went to the jungle or to the field, it was hard. You know, we may be still in the same town, but he's gone for, 30, sometimes 2 months.
Yep.
But, you know, you just have to stay busy, keep yourself busy, keep your kids active, and stay strong. That's all I can tell you.
Absolutely.
And do what
right.
you're supposed to do at home. Mm-hmm. When he comes from out of there, be there with for him. When he comes from out of that field or whenever he comes back from overseas,
right.
you know, both of you guys been apart for so long. It's not going to be where like it used to be, but just give it time. It will grow back.
Exactly
to it.
Right.
You just have to stay strong.
That's a good point, sweet mother. Good point. Because in the military now, it wants to, just like, again, the military is no different than the racist society that it comes from. And in there, they wants to pull the black man and the black woman apart. You understand what I'm saying? So you kind of got to, you know, wedge it in and hang in there.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? To fulfill black man, black woman, black babies, black empowerment.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? So guys, if you like the video, please give us a thumbs up, hit the notification button, subscribe to the channel, share the video with a friend.
Leave a
comment or two if you like, guys.
Positive ones.
Positive comments and stuff. All comments are positive, except for when you make a personal attack.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That's Rick's rule. Sweet daddy's rule. All comments are positive unless you make it a personal attack. And so thank you guys for donating. Thank you guys for being part of our Patreon family.
Yes.
Thank you guys for not skipping ads.
Waiting on us to come from our lag or whatever we got going on. We can't get to you soon enough.
Yeah.
We thank you all.
And guys, believe me, we read the comments when you guys say you're coming to the Gambia. You've made it to the Gambia and we want to get together. Hey, thanks for your patience. It's just sometimes it's difficult dealing with what's going on in your life.
Mm-hmm.
And getting to all the people that are coming to the Gambia in an opportune time, you know what I'm saying? So it's not like, hey, we're snub nose, and you know, like some people, YouTubers, you know, they talk all this smack when you are abroad, but then when you get here, they avoid you.
We're gonna get there. Habitually. We promise you.
No, we will fit you into the schedule. It's just not, it might not be as soon as we like, because right now we know we got some people in country now who wants to go out to the land bag, but we can't because
the rainy
season and the conditions are difficult to drive in there and stuff.
And we don't want
to
put you out there just to get in trouble or hurt yourself or whatever.
Because you do need rain boots to walk through certain areas to be corrected by before
and
next rainy season.
And we want to get to you meeting you in town, but you know.
No vehicle. The vehicles.
No vehicles. And sometimes it's hard just getting a vehicle just to go, you know, do your errands, you know.
That's
but,
true
you
too.
Know, it's all good.
That's true.
We're going to make time. If you guys are still here, just soon as this, next month, we're going to hit you.
Yeah, next month is the end of rainy season. October 15th is the end of the rainy season. All right, guys, you know we end our videos with love, peace, soul. See you next video, bag family.
Bye. It's getting it so hard.